Hey, welcome to the second episode of the Most Serious Podcast. Today we will be talking about philosophy, human psychology, fate, what is free will, and why do people do what they do. I have a friend of mine, Kalyani, with me on this episode. Let's get started.
Welcome to the second episode of our podcast, the Most Serious Podcast. How are you feeling?
Thank you. I am feeling great. I am up to a lot of studies these days and I'm paying a lot of attention to myself. So kind of growing in all aspects, we can say academically, personally, physically, mentally, everything. So I'm taking care of myself in short these days.
Wow, that's amazing. So what exactly do you mean by taking care of yourself these days?
So, I have been, put a background here. I have been neglecting myself for the past 2-3 years, mostly because of academics. And apart from that, because of some personal issues and family issues. So now it was the best time for me because I am a dropper student. So I've got plenty of time for myself. So this is the best time for me to work upon myself and if I want to switch my personality, if I want to make some changes in the way I am, I don't like certain things about the person that I am right now. So it's the best time for me to just switch it or improve it and, go out as a completely different person when I move to college, because I would have no self, previously perceived image of myself in front of people. So I'm just trying to choose between couple of things, what suits me, what doesn't suit me, and what things have helped me in the past, and what things I don't want to carry with myself in the future. All of that. It's just I'm just opening myself up to everything that's happening around me. It's just random and spontaneous. Yeah. Nothing particular.
Okay, great. So, you said that you're opening yourself up to new stuff. Are you particularly diving into topics or diving into areas that you didn't pursue previously per se? We talked about earlier that you're into philosophy, you're into psychology, you want to know why humans do the stuff they do.
Yeah.
So what motivates you, or what got into you that you wanted to pursue, or you wanted to know about all of this stuff? What are your motivations regarding knowing philosophy or understanding the human psychology?
Yeah, okay. So, as far as I know myself, I think it's both inherent and externally motivating also, because my parents are like that. My parents are very spiritually inclined. So, since childhood, I've been observing them, and I've grown up in such an environment where a lot of attention has been paid to one's spiritual aspect. So that is why I'm into all of this. And secondly, from the time I was a kid, if anything used to happen in my life, suppose I have some personal problem or something that's that's not going in a well-aligned manner in my life, then it's always I always tend to look at the situation in such a manner that, okay, this is something that's going on, and what can I do in myself, or what is it trying to tell me that I need to guide myself in such a direction in my life now that I'm in such a spiritual position right now and I need to go there. So it's most of it is just a part of the way I am. So there hasn't been anything a certain event happened in my life and I was okay, now I need to seek my spiritual self or something like that. So it's just a part of the way I am, and also because of the environment I've grown up in, the people I've grown up with. So yes, that's it.
So cool. I think also, as you told that you've grown up in an environment that kind of made your personality or inclined your personality or your interests in a way that brought you to this particular domain or this particular, how do you feel about this let's say philosophy, what's your understanding of philosophy? What do you think of this? What goes on your head when you think about philosophy?
What goes in my head when I think about philosophy? Okay. I don't really know about it very much theoretically, but I think it just explains your life to you. Matlab, there are a lot of people who are like, you know, just living and like they get up, they go to bed, they work 24/7 like some machine, and they have no clue of what they're doing. They're just doing it for the sake of the fact that they did it yesterday and they have to do it tomorrow. So today they're doing the same thing and they do not realize what's actually happening in their life, or they do not even realize that they're living. So like if you tell somebody to just stop, you know, take a breath, look around, maybe that would be the only one moment they would actually realize that they're living and they're not really doing something that has been imposed onto them or some habit that they have been doing for a long time. So philosophy for me was to gain knowledge from this field of philosophy so that I can realize that my life is not, let's say, it doesn't fit only into this 24/7 routine that we have been told to do. It's much beyond than that. Like, I am someone much beyond that. All the roles that I've been designated to play, like a daughter, a student, or whatsoever, apart from that, I am a person and I need to discover that what's my purpose in life. And I think philosophy helps you discover that more than anything else, because it takes you close to yourself. It takes you close to discovering your consciousness. It takes you close to finding out that why actually are we here and what's the purpose of you know, doing things that we keep doing. Because one day we have to stop, and when that one day comes, when all of this is going to end, the work we keep doing, the jobs we take up, all our successes, things we run after all our life, like what after we have achieved them? I don't think life is meant to be some sort of phase that you've achieved something and after that you set another goal and you achieve it, and then you set another goal and you achieve it. There has to be something deeper than that. So philosophy for me is a tool to discover that deeper meaning of my life.
That was, how do I say it? That was a very articulate and a very deep meaning. I agree with you on almost all aspects of it. Because I find myself as a keen observer of the things that go on in my head, or also how do I perceive reality, or how do I think about my life, or for the sake anyone else's life around me. I also tend to think about what is the point of all the stuff that we do. Why do we perform certain actions, or why do we tend to do some things? And why personally I tend to have a different opinion on some things than others. So I relate to you on that phase. Also, I think you mentioned that philosophy allows you to get that deeper sense of meaning in life. So have you had any success finding that deeper sense of meaning in life? Could you enlighten us? Could you tell us something that Kalyani has figured out or she's gotten to some extent that we all could benefit from?
Yeah, actually there have been one or two experiences. I'll tell you. So I was on this school trip and we were trekking. It was like late at night. And I don't till date realize what actually happened, but it was something that had never happened before. And that never happened after that. So it was like during that 1 hour trek, there were some 5 to 10 minutes while I was walking, and I could feel myself. Like I could feel that everything outside of myself, like the ground I was walking on, the air that was you know, flowing, the trees, people who were walking with me, my friends, everybody. I just felt like all of this is a part of me. Like there's something that has just extended outwards around me, but all of this is me. Like for a moment, I just got this feeling that there's nobody else here. It's just you. Like all of this, all these people, everything around you that you can see, you can feel, it's just a part of you. And as crazy as it sounds, as dramatic as it sounds, I don't know, but it was so fulfilling. It just, I didn't want to get out of those 5 or 10 minutes of my life. And I don't know why it happened at that point. The way it happened, I came back and I discussed it with my father because he is a lot into spirituality and philosophy. And he said that, yeah, it must be something, and you were so small to, you know, pay attention to it and go deep into it. So maybe you might never be able to find out what actually happened, why it happened the way it happened, but it was something. So that was one of the incidents that happened with me. And also, I'll tell you what, I am into philosophy and all of this stuff more so because I'm a very, I mean, a trait of my personality is that I'm an empath. Like, I can relate to what the other person is feeling on another level. Sometimes, suppose you're going through something bad in your life and you start narrating it to me. So I can sometimes feel things to such a level that if you tell me that and I listen to it, I feel like that something is happening to me. If you read out an excerpt from a book that contains something very emotional that the character is going through, I start feeling as if the character is me, and I can break down at that very moment. That happens with me so much. So it became very important for me to, because I don't think I'll be able to survive like this if I break down listening to stuff like every stuff like this. I mean, this is very common. Every day you listen to people who are going through bad things or stuff happening to people, and you can't always just imagine yourself to be them and feel that pain because that's like destructive and harmful. So philosophy and all of that was also a tool for me to understand that how can I not feed my emotional side that much and try to develop a practical approach to things. So yeah, I think I have here also again answered why philosophy attracts me and what my take on philosophy is. Plus, yeah, the incident was one of the things that I think made me realize that philosophy affects me, or philosophy is something that intrigues me, or how it has like incorporated itself in my life or in my personality.
That was a very sweet description, what you just told about you trekking on a mountain and you feeling that energy. Also, I think this happens with everyone at some point in their life. Like I could remember various moments that I felt that the universe stands still, and you know, you kind of feel that energy, that it kind of hits you in moments. It comes in waves, and sometimes you just stand there in awe of this whole creation, and you feel that sense of meaning in some sort of way. It's very abstract to tell it to someone, or it's very hard to make them comprehend what you've been going through in that moment, but it certainly happens with everyone, I think. And the way you described it was very interesting. And so I think, yeah, that very interesting too. I also find like people who think about this stuff, like who don't go through their lives by all the mundane routines and the boring jobs they do, or the stuff they do without thinking why they're doing it, or without taking a moment to pause. That makes me a little bit of sad also, because I don't know if it's good to be curious or bad. Certainly it changes the way you think about this world, but I think you are one of those individuals too, and I find myself to be one of them as well, who tend to think about the meaning rather than the work or you know, the act that we have to do.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. Also, I think one of the factors motivating me is fear. Like, every day I just feel that, okay, one more day of my life has passed, and I certainly do not want to spend the rest of my life the way I spent today or yesterday or the day before. So it kind of inspires me. It kind of like pushes me to change something, because what my life is like right now, what I am like right now, or what's happening inside of me, outside of me, all of that, I do not want to continue this. So every day I, like, before I go to bed, consciously or unconsciously, this dawns upon me that, okay, you wasted today. Now you need to, like, gain more knowledge or open up this part of your, this dimension of yourself, or you need to feed this hunger inside of you. Because I don't know if many people even pay attention to this. Like, they're just born, they just do what they are told to do, and then they just die and they waste their life. And it really scares me, because I don't know, it's more of the fear that motivates me than the thirst to know all of that. Because I just feel like my life is slipping away out of my hands, and I don't want that to happen. So yeah.
I think the best part of you telling when you go to bed and you feel like, oh, I wasted another day, I think that would be so relatable to everyone who's listening, because we all go through that phase or that constant reminder of our mind telling ourselves that, hey, you didn't do shit today, man, what's up. So that's actually very funny. Now tell me, like, what do you think about I'm really interested to know, and I want to know as many people's opinion that I can get on this. What's your understanding of reality? Like, what keeps you sane? What makes you believe that? Why are you doing stuff? Why? And how are you also perceiving reality? Like, how do you think about dimensions and stuff? Like, what is real and what is not, according to you?
Actually, this is something that I've been in a lot of, let's say, I faced a lot of dilemma in this aspect. And not long back, just like 2 weeks back, the entire week, like a few months back, I went through something. Like, it was some mental turmoil kind of a thing. So maybe what happened was a part of that. Maybe it was not. I don't know, but it's related to that. So that entire week, I won't lie about this. I'm completely honest. I could not differentiate what was real, what was a part of my dream, what did I see whilst I was sleeping, and what was actually happening. Like, it was so incomprehensible for me. I did not know when I was awake, and I did not know what was actually happening and what was actually a fragment of my imagination. So I think this question, I don't think I am capable enough to answer it right now, because that was one of the first experiences that I had in this aspect. And from there, actually, I started to think about this, that, okay, something like this also happens, and I, like, this is weird, this is crazy stuff. I haven't ever put myself in such a situation where I could not differentiate between what's real and what's not, and what's abstract and what's imaginative. Like, so I was completely new to it. So I don't think I'm afraid I won't be able to do justice with the answer to this question, but like, this was one of my very first experiences that actually made me question this thing, or it was the first time that such a question popped up in my mind. So yeah, even I would like to know about this. I would like to know your take on this because I think that's going to help me since I don't know a lot about this. So yeah.
Honestly, Kalyani, no one knows about this because the people have been trying for thousands of years into making some sense into these arguments or these questions or ideas. I also when I stumbled upon the concept of reality or questioned it for myself, I read about certain theories, and one that really stuck with me was there was a famous guy, René Descartes. And I don't know if you might have heard of him. He was a mathematician, philosopher, all sorts of things. So what he also had this same struggle. So what he did was he started to imagine, like he took this thought experiment, and what he did was he imagined that all of the stuff that is in my head is not real. I can't take it for is that real or not, like. He took all of his thoughts, his perceptions, his beliefs, and he threw them out of the window. And he thought that I'll start from scratch. It's like you have a basket of apples. So if you want to know that which apples are good and which apples are bad, so what you do is you take all the apples out, you find the bad apples, and then you just put the good apples back in. So this is what René Descartes did. So he threw out all his beliefs, his perceptions out of the window. And then he started putting only those back into his brain or into his mind or into his thoughts that he thought he could certainly quantify as real, or he could prove them as facts. So whilst doing this experiment, he found that there were very less things that he could say this that they are a fact or they are true. When you just break down all the, when you break down all the basis of any argument, or when you break down the basis of any understanding. So it's very hard to find facts, because facts are also, they are a certain level of, a sure shot thing that is happening, but it's based on a understanding. So when you take out like everything out of your brain and you suspect every idea or every thought or every principle, so that leaves you with very less. So René Descartes also had this same problem in his thought experiment. But one thing that made him realize that he was real or not, he also questioned that whether I am also real or not, because he couldn't prove that am I real or not, do I have this body or not. So what he found while doing this experiment was he found that he was questioning his existence, or he was questioning that he was real or not. So what that made him sure of was that he had a brain, or he had a mind, or he had something that allows him to question everything. So that made him sure of that if he has a mind, I don't know if it's making sense or not, but if he has a mind, then only he could be able to question everything. So that was his basic argument, which led to his further beliefs. And eventually he just put everything back into his basket, like one thing led to the other, and all of his beliefs came back. But the one belief was that I doubt everything, therefore I am able to be sure of the fact that I have a mind which is able to doubt. So therefore he said, I think, therefore I am. That is a very famous philosophical quote. So that was his understanding of how he perceived reality.
Yeah, I think it made complete sense to me. And you know, when you said that the fact that he had something that could question if everything was real, including himself, then that's something. It can be his mind, it can be something else, consciousness, whatever. That something is real because it's able to question the reality. It's able to question whether things are real or not. So, yeah, I think it made complete sense to me. And thank you so much for telling me all of this, because, yeah, I think it's something that I would now maybe indulge a lot in since I've got to know stuff about this.
I honestly, I started plan for an episode or think about what I'm going to talk about today. I always remind myself that you shouldn't go on talking about minutes and not make any sense. And I think this was a classic example of it. But if it made sense to you, I think that went well. Also, now since we were discussing reality and you mentioned consciousness and you mentioned how did you understand the concept of reality, like, so one of the major questions that divides people's opinion or is question of fate, the question of free will, or are you really in control of your life? Are you in charge of what is happening? So what's your view on it? Fate, free will?
So I have always been the one who used to believe a lot in fate. Things are supposed to happen a certain way. Things are meant to happen this way. You cannot change it. It's all written. It will go this way despite whatever you do. Like, if you are meant to succeed, then even if you're the laziest person on earth, you'll succeed, which makes no sense to me today because it's like the most bullshit thing I've ever heard in my life. So I don't think I believe in the existence of fate prior to your doing something that actually influences your fate. So, you know, I believe that your work, your choices, coincidences and fate, all of these things go hand in hand. So it's more about your, like, today, the person I am, I believe that you write your fate by the things you choose and the things you reject. Like, at every point in your life, you have countless, you know, there are countless ways in which your life can turn out basing on one decision that you take. You know, like they talk about the parallel universe. So I think there are like infinite parallel universes where infinite realities might be existing, infinite potential futures might be existing based on what decision you decide to take today. So I think fate is a concept. This is my very personal opinion and I'm like trying to put it out very humbly. Fate must have originated based on the concept of not, you know, holding yourself accountable for the choices you're making or the decisions you're making. I think that's where fate, the concept of fate and putting all the accountability and blame on your fate arised from, because it's on me. I, like, at this point I can choose to do anything with my life. That's going to decide how my life goes. There's no some predefined book that has been written before I was born that I'm going to take this decision at this point of my life and so my life will turn out in so and so way. It's just our universe is like, you know, it's based on quantum physics. It's scientific. It's all calculative. So everything here is, it's all a play of probabilities. It's all a play of choices. It's all a play of mathematics and science. It's everything you do is going like, it's a, let's say, a web of combinations. I mean, I am not, I didn't study mathematics for like a long period of time. I was a bio student, so I don't know how to put it out very well. But I think it's more about what you decide to do at a particular point in your life rather than thinking that, okay, I was supposed to do this, and even if I don't do this, things will turn out the way I want them to or the way they were supposed to, despite of me taking actions that actually contradict what I'm expecting. So, yeah, I think there's nothing like fate that you can rely on. You have to create your fate by the choices you make. The only thing that can help you is the opportunities or the coincidences in your life, but they can just add to what your life will turn out to be or what a particular result of a situation is going to be. But at the end, it all comes down to you making that one choice out of the 100 choices that are available in front of you.
I think very interestingly, you made a perfect jingle or a rhyme that I could use for this episode. It was create your fate by the choices you make. That should be, I think, written on posters or some stuff like that. If you go on and become super successful in your life, you could give out quotes like this. I think one of my arguments whenever I discuss fate and free will to people is I always tend to debate against the side that they're taking. So since you said there's no fate, or like it doesn't make sense to me particularly that a fate does exist for you, like you said. So there's a hypothesis that I came across recently, and it said, you also mentioned that the universe or the whole cosmos works on probability, it works on particles, atoms. So if we as human beings, or we as how do you say, like primary existing whatever we are made up of particles, if our minds are made up of particles, atoms, which behave probabilistically, like it's in general science also, you like get to know the behavior of an atom, or the I think it was a theory of I don't remember the guy's name, but he gave like you can get to know the position or the speed of an atom like at one particular point or some stuff like that. I totally forgot it, but if these particles or atoms behave probabilistically, then how do you think you have free will? If they are even not in your control, like you're not even in control of the stuff you're made of, so how can you say that you're in control of the actions you're taking?
I think I mean, what you said makes a lot of sense, but free will, we do have free will to the extent that out of all the probabilities, the, like you said, that those atoms and those subatomic particles, all of they behave or move probabilistically. So probability offers choice, right? So we do have the choices that exist within that sphere of probability. And I think when we use the term probability, does it not mean that like any choice can be a part of probability? I mean, I don't know how to put myself out very comprehensibly, but probability, it's in itself is a term that states that anything in a confined bunch of choices, you can choose any of those choices. So I think in that, up to that extent, free will is maybe exercisable. So yeah, that is what I wanted to say, but I think now I am going to question my own statement there after you mentioned this. So yeah, that was like a very good counterpoint. It was great. Yeah,
I mean, listen, what I do is, if you would have taken the side of free fate, I would have put in across a hypothesis that supports free will. So that's all I contribute to these discussions. I am the guy who, the annoying person who won't just settle for any explanation. Now, what do you believe, like, also I'm particularly interested in knowing that, do you believe it's good to have choices? Like, it's always good to have choices?
I have, like, two very different opinions here. I think sometimes it's good to have choices because it makes us more sure of what choice we finally make. Like, suppose out of 100 things, you choose that one thing, and you stick to that one thing despite the other 99 choices available to you, then it makes you more sure about the shot you're gonna take. And in the second opinion that I have is, it's not good to have a lot of choices because it makes it difficult for you to, you know, go out there, try and find out what actually resonates with you. Because now you have 100 ways, or let's say 100 things that might resonate with you, and you are gonna have to try all those 100 things to see if it works for you or not, unless you are not sure of one thing, like that you have pre determined in your mind. So yeah, I think it's both good and bad. It depends on your conditioning. It depends on the fact whether you are somebody who is always sure shot of their choices, and so you don't have to pay attention to the other 99 choices if you've chosen that one choice out of the 100 ones. But if you're somebody who is not always sure of the choices they make, or who doesn't always rely on that one choice, then I think it becomes a tough job for you to, you know, just try out all the things that are available in front of you. In that aspect, I think a limited, confined set of choices that relate the most to your values is representing you with that set of choices would be a better option, rather than opening up like thousands of choices in front of you. So yeah, that's what I think about.
All right. I think, yeah, I also believe with you. I also believe you, and I think also, like, how do you feel about, in the last episode I discussed a lot of tech and AI. So what's your take in it? Like, are you a new techy sort of person who's always interested in what's going on with the tech guys, or what's happening, what progress are we making, how further are we getting to creating artificial intelligence, or do you prefer old school way of life, like simplistic value and people just, you know, going about their lives in a very simple manner? I think
I'm a completely old school person. I know nothing. I'm not at all a tech freak. If anything, I'm the opposite of that. So I'm just, like, I sometimes even mention it to my friends and to my family that I think I'm born in this wrong decade. I think I should have taken birth way back. This is not the place for me. These people, I don't relate with them. I'm sorry. Don't think I relate with the tech advancements that have been going on, or I pay a lot of attention to them. It just comes out, like, things they make just come out, the developments they make just come out, and I am one of those people who is happy sitting here and using them. But I don't really, like, I mean, put a lot of work into knowing how things are developing, or why they are developing the way they are, and all of that. I'm completely old school.
You said that you're born into the wrong decade, probably. So which decade does Kalyani want to exist in, or what century?
I think,
for the matter.
I don't think I would like to go like farther than the 20th century. So maybe the 1990s or 80s, I don't know. The decade our parents belong to, most probably. The decade when they were young or in colleges, I think that's the place I belong to, or that's the decade I belong to, for that matter. This, I do not resonate with what's going on right now in the world at all, at any level.
That's pretty recent. I mean, I was expecting an answer like, I would have wanted to be born in 1330s or some stuff like that, you know, being a queen in that era, having not to be disturbed by the modern issues or problems that we face in our day-to-day. That's pretty recent. I mean, that I think that doesn't even contribute to the argument. You're saying that you wanted to be born like, what, 20, 30 years back. I was expecting, like, you would have said, I want to be born 1200 or...
Yeah, no. That era, I wouldn't have been able to survive. Most of us, I think all of us. I who wants to go back to such an era? It was a time of inventions and discoveries, and people were minded and all of that stuff. But no, once you've tasted the comfort of the 21st century, why would you want to go back to those old times? That's too much.
Honestly, I'd go back if they made me some king. Or I think that was a very lavish lifestyle. The people that were lucky enough. But yeah, honestly, for the masses, this is the better time to be alive. Also, like, are you a night person or a morning person? And what difference does it make? Like, does it have a difference to you?
I think I've been both at different points in my life. But if like I have to prefer something, I think definitely mornings. It's scientifically proven, and I'm talking from experience as well. I think I would love to be a morning person if consistently. Most of the times I am a morning person, but not like very consistent with it. The difference between being a night person and a morning person is, I think I'm more, mostly people are more efficient in the mornings, because it also has a lot to do with your body clock. You know, it's the diurnal rhythm, the 24/7 clock that's running in your body. I think biologically we function our best during certain times of the day, and I think the dawn, the time post 12 up to 4 or 5 or 6 a.m. in the morning, that's the time that is the best for your body to rejuvenate itself, to repair itself. And I think people who choose that time to sleep rather than stay up, I think they do a lot better in all the aspects of life than people who stay up late. I mean, people who stay up late also might do all these things or be good at all these things, but that comes with a lot of, personally I'm talking about it, that comes with a lot of disadvantage, or let's say side effects. Like I have, when I used to be a night person, my mornings were hell. Like I wasn't awake till like 2. Even though I was awake physically, I wasn't awake mentally. It was a struggle, and then headaches and like physical issues. Didn't feel like eating, appetite was lost. Didn't feel like exercising because there was no energy in my body. I was still lethargic. When I wake up in the morning, the best thing about waking up in the morning is that it gives you a lot more time than you feel you have when you wake up around noon, because you sleep too late at night because you're a night person. So one of the factors is, I think, getting a lot of time on your hands, a lot more time than you would get if you were a night person. And time is all, I think, what all of us are craving for today. So yeah, you definitely get time. You are not lethargic. Your body aligns with the tasks you are supposed to do at particular points of the day. Your appetite remains constant. In fact, it improves when you're a morning person. So yeah, I think all these factors, personally, I've observed.
You're giving very strong mom vibes. Started lecturing about morning routines and why you should get up in the morning. My mom keeps saying that stuff to me. But honestly speaking, from my experience, I can relate to what you were saying. I started waking up early like a couple of weeks back. Other than that, for the past year, like I've been after 1 a.m. or 2 a.m. probably every night, and waking up 11 or 12 a.m. in the morning. But the difference that I felt in the past couple of weeks is I don't overthink as much as I did like when I was staying up late. I don't know if it makes sense, or it does actually is a effect due to my waking hours or something like that. But this is one major difference that I found, because I feel most of us get into an anxious state or into a overthinking state at night only. I don't know if it's true for everyone, but I found myself to be involved in more active things during the day, which eats up the time that your mind could have, or it would have, you know, and it would lead you to the path of just realizing everything that you did wrong in your life and all those cringe moments that you had in your life, and you know, you just feel like a failure and all of the stuff like that. So I think that's one very major difference that I felt in the past 2 weeks waking up early.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. These post 12 post 1 AMRs, they make you very, they take you to a very vulnerable spot. I mean, I have, as much as I prefer being a morning person, I have been someone, and not like way back, I guess a month or two back, I started sleeping at around 4 or 5. And like I have relatively I've picked up different kinds of routines. I've slept at 10 and woken up at 3. Like when I used to prepare for my examination the first time, this is my schedule. Then I shifted it from this to 12 to 5. And then I started sleeping at 5 and waking up at 10. So that 5 to 10 was, it was really bad. Now that I look at it, it was like, I mean, by 4 or 5, not only was I sleeping, but my head was full of shitty things. It was like you said, all the failures and all those cringe moments of your life, definitely. And it makes you do things that you would question doing 1,000 times during the day. It just, like, you know, as they say, that it wakes the devil in you up, it wakes the Satan inside of you up, it makes you lose sense. Actually, there's something about that point of time, and I think that's why it's the best to just use it for sleeping instead of, you know, ending up doing something that you keep regretting over and over again. It's definitely a very vulnerable duration to be awake at, you know, especially start overthinking, which all of us do if you're awake at. So yeah, I agree with all of what you said, definitely. That is the major difference that people fail to notice.
I think, I don't know if you relate to this or if I used to get such mad urges to sort my life during 1 a.m., you know, 12:30 a.m., 2 a.m. It just went like, bro, you just have to sort your life out, and you have to sort it out in this moment. So you start thinking about stuff like, what can I do? What can I do today? What can I do in this moment? Like, you know, and you make really huge promises to yourself, man. I'll put in 5 hours, 6 hours of work. I'll start working out tomorrow. And what can I do in this moment also? I'll start organizing my room. And honestly, in that moment, you are overwhelmed with the work that you have at hand, because most of our lives are not as you plan them to be. So that was a feeling that I'm very happy to get rid of, honestly, because I'm not awake in those hours. Like, I'm not awake after 12 mostly. So I don't get that sudden urge to radically change my life overnight, you know, just to completely overturn things. That's a very liberating. That keeps you very lightweight, I guess.
Yeah, I think that's right. In fact, that happens with me a lot. I have made countless schedules at 1 a.m. at night, which I've never ever followed. All of them have gone to the dustbin. I've got urges at 2 a.m. to just get up from my bed, get out of my blanket and start. I've done that. Like, it was my time to sleep, and I was like, okay, if you didn't study today, then you're definitely going to fail. So you got to study right now. So I've gotten up and I've studied for like the entire morning, only to like feel lethargic for the entire day. It's there, and it's a very strong urge. It's like, I would have been like mad happy if I got that urge consistently during the day, because it would have definitely helped me change my life. But you just get that very strong urge to change things like momentarily, I guess. So although it's very powerful, but again, it's momentarily, it passes away quickly. So rather than, you know, getting the high of it at night, I think we should start small, taking, you know, not making a lot of difference in our lives, but like start with little steps and differences that ultimately take you there, so that you're ready to make those changes in your life rather than depending on some 1 or 2 a.m. high. But today I'm going to like conquer the world and all of that. All of us feel that.
So yeah, back on the question. Would you rather experience the beginning of Earth, or would you rather experience the end of Earth?
That's a very, very interesting question. Yeah, I think I would rather experience the end. Not the Why? Beginning, yeah. Definitely the end. Why the end? I don't know, because I think we have studied about the beginning. We have learned things about the beginning. We know something about the beginning, at least, if not everything. But the end is not what we know about. And what we also don't know is how the end is going to take place. I think, yeah, I would rather prefer to know what we don't know than know what we know something about. So, yeah, it's not a very deep reason for me to experience the end of the earth. But, yeah, it's my own reason, I think. I would prefer to go through the end of the earth.
All right. I also think, the end of the earth would be interesting to watch if you're not inside Earth for the time being. The beginning of Earth, also I still believe that the beginning of Earth would be as much interesting as the end of Earth, because what we have are theories based on certain sciences that we have established as a society or as a human race, but we weren't actually present at that time. At the beginning of Earth, it's just looking inside a book, but narrowed by the structure of the principles that you formulated. So either of them would be a great experience, but the end would definitely be more interesting because we are not really sure about.
Yeah, right. That's very true. I agree with that. Yes.
And this marks the end of our second episode. I hope you enjoyed it. We will be back again soon with another very interesting conversation.